So again, if you're just joining the lecture, just try to draw the automata for this corresponding language. A raised to power n, b raised to power n, where n is greater than equal to 1. Okay, so it can be 0 also, but I just want to raise it to the power of 1. And in that way, the language that is possible here, the smallest string will be AB after that, because n is written here. So if I just raise it to the power of 2, so both of them will raise it to the power of 2. So it means that it will become AABB. If I just raise it to the power of 3, it will become AAABBB. Okay. So just try to form a automata if you can. Okay. So just take like 5 minutes and try to draw the automata. So I just know that you are able to design it so that we can move forward. Okay, just take like 5 minutes. Now it is 2:33. I will tell you the answer in 2:38. If anybody has solved it before, just share your screenshot. Okay. So I think okay, so most of you will get the solution that is given by Mayank. Okay, so most of you will get the solution, but if you clearly see that in that automata the string AAB is also getting accepted. Okay, so for this type of automata you cannot draw a DFA. Okay, so why is this happening? Because after seeing two A's, I have to remember that I have seen two A's and now I have to see two B's. Okay, so this is a part where the things get tricky for DFA. Okay, so I have to remember that I have seen three A's. After remembering it, I again have to see three A's. Only then I can design a specific automata. So to remember something, I need memory. Okay, so for that, the DFA or finite automata does not have any memory. Okay, so it does not contain any memory. No memory is designated to this DFA. So that is why the expression or the automata or the DFA for that particular language cannot be derived. Okay, so now I just given you the example of a language that we haven't seen earlier. And for that language where we are not able to design a DFA, okay? So I just want to explain it that there are some languages, I just write it like this. Some languages are called regular languages, if you remember. So there is something called a regular grammar. Okay, so this, what are we exactly studying? We are exactly studying a finite automata, okay? So now this grammar, these grammars are your generators. Okay, so these grammars are your generators. So if you see, your English language is a generator which generates English language. Okay, so it generates a regular language. So regular grammar is a generator for regular language. And that regular language is accepted by an acceptor. Okay, so what we are studying acceptors. Okay, so now if you see that the specific example of this regular language can be e raised to power n, where n is equal to greater than 1. For any language for which a automata, specifically a finite automata, can be for any language, if a finite automata can be constructed, okay, so you can design a finite automata for any language, that language is called your regular language. Okay, so the example for this will be this. Okay, so any language for which you can able to draw a DFA or a NFA, or simple Moore and Mealy machine, if you're able to draw it, it means that language is your a regular language, and that regular is generated by something called a regular grammar. Okay, so generators are grammar, that those things that generate grammars are called regular gram generators. Okay, so those who generate grammars are called generators, and those who accept language are called acceptors. Okay, so this regular grammar generate regular language. Similarly, there is another type of language called a context-free language. Okay, so context-free language. Okay, so this context-free language is accepted by something called a push-down automata. Okay, so the example of this language is we have seen that a raised to power n, b raised to power n, where n is greater than equal to 1. So that particular language is not a regular language. Okay, so now a raised to power n, b raised to power n is not accepted by a finite automata, so you cannot call this a regular language. Okay, so for that language to be accepted, a raised to power n, b raised to power n, we need a memory. Okay, so finite automata plus memory is called your push down automata. So we have given a new name to this. Whenever we add a memory to this finite automata, we call this as push down automata. So don't worry about it right now. We will design various PDAs. Don't worry about it. Okay, just let me write it like this. Okay, so now there is another type of language. Now clearly see that I am marking the boxes like that. Okay, so it means that regular language is a subset of this language that is called your context-free language. In the same way, there is another thing called context-sensitive language. Don't worry about it. We will discuss each and everything in detail. Okay. So the example of it will be a raised to power n, b raised to power n, c raised to power n, where n is greater than 1. Don't worry about that right now. We will study about it. So these are just a basic overview of the hierarchy of the languages. Okay. In the same way, the final set is your called your recursive enumerable set. So these type of languages are accepted by the these kind of languages are accepted by your linear bounded automata. In the same way, the boxes will also follow like this. Okay, so the PDA is a superset of finite automata. In the same way, linear bounded automata is a superset of finite PDA and finite and PDA. In the same way, the biggest superset of all of these is called your Turing machine. In the similar way, to generate a context-free language, we need a context-free grammar. Okay, so that is also a superset. In the same way, if you want to generate a context-sensitive language, we need a context-sensitive grammar. Okay, so similarly, this thing is called your unrestricted grammar. So any kind of string, there is no exactly rule followed in the end one. So Turing machine can accept any kind of a grammar. So don't worry. Okay, so the main part from main takeaway from this is that finite automata, the languages that are accepted by finite automata are called regular languages. Okay, so keep that in mind. Okay, so if the finite automata is not able to recognize the language, or you cannot construct a finite automata for a particular language, it means that particular language is not a regular language. Okay, so we have seen the example that we are not able to design a finite automata for a raised to power n, b raised to power n, where n is greater than equal to 1. So if you remember, we have done this question, a raised to power n, b raised to power m. Okay, so keep that in mind. This is different thing. It means that n and m are not dependent upon each other. So this is like this, a star, b star, where you know the value of star. Okay. So this star is not dependent upon this star. If I write this in a regular expression, this star is not dependent upon this star. Keep that in mind. Now I just want to say that now.
So,
yeah, please.
Sir, what is the language for Turing machine?
What is the language for Turing machine?
As in over here.
Okay. The second box. Recursive enumerable set language. Okay. Recursive enumerable set language. Right now, don't worry about it. This is also divided into two parts. That is recursive language. And in the outer part, you will get recursive enumerable. In the similar way, if you see the regular languages are not divided, but the context-free will also be divided. When I go in detail, I will tell you about each and every. Don't worry about right now. So recursive enumerable set is the language set that is accepted by the Turing machine. And keep that in mind that I told you in Dude also, but think of it like this. This is a finite automata, and this finite automata is like a lower ranking officer. Okay, so when it got promoted, it will go towards the push down automata. So this is a post name. Okay, so this push down automata, when promoted, will go towards the linear bounded automata, and that will promote it go towards the Turing machine. So that is the highest level of promotion. So what do I mean by this? That finite automata can able to accept the regular languages. So does the PDA. Okay, so PDA comes from finite automata. So it comes from a lower post. So it knows how to accept the regular language. Okay, so in the similar way, that finite automata accept only regular languages, nothing other than that. If a regular that is accepted by a finite automata, then that language is called your regular language. Okay, so PDA can accept regular language as well as context-free language also. In the similar way, if I just write it like this, that finite automata can only accept regular language. But if you see, that is a superset. PDA is a superset, and it comes and it comes from very, very bottom here. So it means that he has done the work of regular language. So he knows how to parse the regular language, and it as well as he's performing its on duties also. Okay. So occasionally, if any regular language come, PDA can parse it as well as its own work he's also doing, that he can also parse context-free language. Okay. In a similar way, linear bounded automata can also parse regular language, context-free language, as well as its own language, that is your context-sensitive language. In a similar way, Turing machine can parse all the languages. So it means that regular language, be it regular, context-free, context-sensitive, as well as its own language, that is your recursive language. Okay. So keep that in mind. If I just say that, if I just write a statement like LBA can accept a regular language, is it true or false statement? So this is a true statement, because LBA is a superset. LBA is a superset of finite automata. So that is how it is accepting it. But if I say, can LBA accept a recursive enumerable set? So that is a false statement, okay? So always keep these things in mind, that what is the superset and what is the subset, okay? So now moving on forward, we have studied regular expression in the previous lecture. Now what, there are four things. Okay, so first thing is generators. So generator is your grammar. Any particular grammar is your generator. After that, this generator will generate a certain language. So the second part is your language. And the third part, the languages that are generated are accepted by a particular acceptors. Okay, so the last final one is your, that we have studied, the regular expression, that is called your representer. Okay, so the regular languages are represented by something called a regular expression. Okay, so that is why regular expressions are called the representer. So any language for which a automata, more specifically a finite automata, that can be finite automata can be drawn, that language is called your regular language. And to represent this language, we use a regular expression. Okay, so we have done this, like many questions regarding this, and also in tutorial also the questions are available for this. So don't worry about that right now. Okay, so now I think we have done with, because the last lecture were combined lecture, so that part I have not covered in your class, so that is it. So this is just a hierarchy of languages, or hierarchy of grammars, or hierarchy of acceptors. So don't just cram it. We will again go with the, do everything individually. So we are with finite automata, and we are now standing at regular languages and regular grammar. Well, I will also tell you in the same way, CFL, CSL and recursive set. We will do all of this. Okay, so we will do in this fashion, that we will study finite automata. After that, we will study pushdown. After that, LB, after that, TU. If you studied finite automata, you will already get what exactly this language and grammar is. It's very easy. I will tell you in like 15 minutes, you can understand what I want to say. Okay, so keep that in mind, that regular expression is a representer. I don't know how all of you have done this question wrong, that I have said that regular expression is the generator. So generator is not the right answer. Regular expression is the representer of the regular languages. So generator is a grammar. So most of you, I don't know why most of you in the quiz have written that statement false. Okay. So now,
sir, can we also include NFA with FA over there in the box?
NFA with FA over there? Where?
Sir, in the above box.
Fourth? Yeah, yeah, but.
Sir, above. More
above.
So over here.
Here?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, you can absolutely include NFA, DFA, finite automata without output. So Murray and Melle will also come in this finite automata set. Okay. Now we have done some questions regarding regular expression. Now we just, if there is another procedure called Arden's theorem. Okay, so Arden's theorem, keep that in mind. Arden's theorem is just a little bit of a mathematical calculation to calculate a regular expression from NFA or a DFA. Mostly it's NFA, it will be NFA, it can be a DFA also. You know, every NFA is a DFA also. Every DFA is NFA. So regular expression from NFA or a DFA. So I have to particularly write like that. Okay. So this is just a mathematical calculation to calculate a regular expression that we have studied. If you remember that this is a regular expression A plus B star. Okay. So from a NFA. So first condition that we have to do, we have to get a drawing of a construction of a NFA. Keep that in mind. Okay. So other thing is, it is not applicable to epsilon NFA. Okay. So if any epsilon exists in the construction in the finite machine, so I cannot apply Arden's theorem on that. Okay. So I just open the slides. Okay. Just let me see if you have any question. Okay. So I think you don't have any question. So now, before continuing, there are some regular expression identities. Okay, so identities are mathematical proofs that I am just writing it as it is. Okay, so keep that in mind. There are some important proofs here. So I don't think that we just go on and see the each proof ourselves, that how it is possible and how it is not. Okay, so if you still want to see how this proof is extracted, you can go towards your respective books and you can find the proof of every identity that is written here. Okay, so don't worry about that. I will tell you most important identities, and it can be understandable by just seeing at it. So it is understandable by just seeing at it. Okay, so A plus B star, if you remember, is also equal to A star followed by a B star raised to power a whole star. Okay, so if you do not write this whole star, what will happen? So it can happen that if any number of A's can come, any number of B's can come, but after B, the repetition of A cannot come. So in A plus B star, what happens after B, A can come any number of times, and again a B can come. But if you do not write this star, what will happen? Any number of A's can come followed by any number of B's, or a single B or any number of B's can come, but after the arrival of B, A cannot come. So that is why there is a necessity of adding a star here. So what happens with adding a star? If I just write A plus B star raised to power 2, so I can write like this. So it can be written as A star B star followed by A star B star. Okay, so now you can extract, now from here it can be B, from here it can be A. Okay, so by getting a B, you can again get I. Okay, so that this thing and this thing is one and the same thing. If you see, you can replace it with that. In the same way, A star, B star, raised to power star. Again, all of these identities are equal. So A plus B star star and A followed by a B star. So this is a bit different. Okay, so that, keep that in mind. Okay, so if you want to see it, you just generate different number of strings, any number of strings, and you will find that the number of strings that are generated by A plus B star is also are also the same number of strings that are generated by this expression. Okay, so keep that thing in mind, that this is equivalent to these kinds of expression. In the similar way, in the set theory, just consider this phi as 0 and epsilon as 1. Okay, so there is no formal notation, so to remember it easily or to see the identities, I am just giving you some informal notation so that you can easily see it. Okay, so R plus phi or phi plus R, you can replace it by changing the placement it, and it can be written as 0 plus R. So it is R. So 0 plus R is R. In the same way, when R is multiplied by any epsilon is 1. So it will become your R. So if you consider it, it will be fairly easy to understand what is written here. Okay, so it can the placement of it can be changed. So this is also equal to this. In the same way, 0 is multiplied by L, it is equal to a phi. So it is equal to 0.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
So in the first one, how is A star B A star, the last we have written, how is it valid? Because sir, if we take for example all our ones, we'll get an A B A. B cannot be more than 1.
in any expression. We can repeat that expression again, but in single individual expression, we can only be one there.
Yeah, absolutely right. If I just raise it to the power of 3, you can get any number of b's.
Sir, I'm saying it will get ba, ba, ba 3 times. But of what if I want b, ba or b 5 times then a? We won't get that right.
This one. You want to derive 5, just say 4 times b followed by a. Yeah?
Yeah. That's what I'm saying in this one. We won't be able to get that.
Okay, so just I just derive it. Okay. So a followed by a b a star. I just raise it to the power. I just raise this to the power. I don't worry about right now. The power of a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. So I will just raise it to the power of 4. Okay. So I can write it like this, that b a b a b a and b a. Now here is star always be there. Okay. So star will always be there. So here you can again change individually the power of star for b. B, I just raise it for this a, I just raise it to the power of 0. For b, I just raise it to the power of 0. For b,
okay,
I raise
it to the power.
Okay. Absolutely. Okay. So always just write some numbers, you will get it. Okay. So that are proven identities that are written here. Okay. So in the similar way, if you see 0 is multiplied by any language or any L is also a regular expression, keep that in mind. So any regular expression, if you multiply it, you will again get an epsilon. So that is a bit different. Keep that in mind. Okay. So if you consider, keep that in mind. I am just telling you informally so that you can easily understand this expression that phi is equal to 0. But formally it is not there. Okay. So formally it is not equal to 0. So this is just for your remembering. So R plus R can also be written as R. So that is an idempotent law. So I hope that you have studied these laws, the right distribution, left distribution, and I think in digital as well as in discrete. So they are one and the same thing. Okay. So L, this is your left distribution law. So you can write that like this, L into M and L into N. So this is one and the same thing, M into L and M into L. So this is right distributive law. Okay. So now this thing is very, very important here. So you haven't seen this when there is an epsilon plus RR star. First of all, you can write this RR star as a R here. So if you see A followed by a star, okay, so it can be written like a star only. Okay, so that is why they are written that if you see that regular expression identity here. Okay, so this one, sorry for that. I think the identity was this one R star, but this is R star also. No, there is no identity. Okay, so keep that in mind whenever there is this kind of thing is written, epsilon plus R star, it can be replaced to a R star. Okay, so this is also a very important identity. So I will tell you the application of these identities. So when we are solving some expressions like Arden's theorem, these identities will come into play. Okay, so if you the important one is this identity, keep that in mind. Another one is fairly very simple, so these are easily understandable. These are concatenation and these are addition of a phi set, so there is nothing to it. But this is a different identity here. So if you see that whenever you raise a star, raise to the power of star of phi here, it becomes epsilon. So that is a bit different than any other one. So this is different. Keep that in mind. So this is important also. Whenever you raise your phi to the power of star, you will get epsilon. In the similar way, so 1 raised to power any number of ones, so it will be epsilon again. So R star can also be written. So this is just a change of a placement. In the same way, R star, so it is saying A star. So it is saying any number of A's can come followed by any number of A's. So I can already directly write the like this, that A star, any number of A's can come. So it is one and the same thing. If you remember in the tut, I think we have done this question where 0 plus 1 star followed by 0 plus 1. I have told you that whenever there are something like this are repeating, you can check the regular expression and delete something in there, because that forward expression will always be accommodated in the final one. Okay, so that is the similar thing also here. Okay, so R star can also be written as R star.
R star star is also one and the same thing. It is just raised to power a star, and R star is just a change of the placement. So this is one and the same thing. So again, it is repeated. So don't worry about that. So it is again the placement change here. So Q PQ star can also be QP star written as QP star, and the placement of P can be changed. Okay. So the main thing that this expression is a bit different, and keep in mind that epsilon plus R star R can be written as R star. Okay. So epsilon plus R star R. So keep this thing in mind. Okay. In another way, this is also very a bit different. And all of these are, I think, fairly understandable. There is nothing more complex in it. So this is a bit different, and this is a bit different that we cannot be able to comprehend on our own. So just keep these two expression, these two most important expressions in mind. Okay. So now I will show you the application of this. So just hold for a minute. I will tell you how it is relevant to our Arden's method. Okay. So they will be applicable to Arden's method. So now again, Arden's method is just a mathematical method. It's a very simple method. Just do not overcomplicate the stuff. Just follow the simple Arden's method. You will always find a solution. Be it a very, very big automata, be it a very big NFA, you will always find the solution. Okay, so if you just stick to the method, okay, it just says that P and Q are two regular expression, and the first assumption that we made that P does not belongs to a null string. Okay, so null string can be a lambda or a phi epsilon. Okay, so in some books instead of epsilon, lambda is used. Okay, so keep that in mind. That is one and the same thing. So null string, if you remember, null string is called a epsilon and a null set is called a phi. So don't confuse epsilon and phi. So first assumption is that if P and Q are two regular expressions, so first assumption is that P should not be a null string, and then then for this equation R equal to Q plus RP, there is a unique solution exists that can be written like this, R equal to QP star. Okay, so in the next, the proof is also given. I will again give you simple proof that you don't understand. If you don't understand it, I just go it there. I will again give you a very simple proof that you will easily understand it. So there the equation is written like this, that Q, I just see what was the equation, R equal to Q plus RP. Okay, so I can write R equal to Q plus RP. Okay, so first keep that in mind that P, Q, R is your belongs to a regular expression. So all of these are regular expression. It can be A plus B, it can be A, it can be B, anything. Okay. Now, what exactly is the condition that I think Q doesn't belong to, P does not belong to a null string. Okay. So keep that in mind that P here should not belong to a lambda or a epsilon. Okay. So lambda and epsilon is one and the same thing. Then you can directly write this expression as a QP star. Okay. So what if you want to see that if it is the correct solution, then just take this R and put the value of R in this. Okay. So I just take this R and Q plus QP star followed by a P. Okay. So if I just extract the Q from here, so Q, it will become epsilon. From one is, so if you remember, there is nothing there. So we are talking in the form of regular expression. So if it is nothing there, so one is not the valid here. So I will add epsilon here, epsilon followed by a P star P. Okay. So now if you clearly see, I have seen this regular identity. I already told you that see this regular identity, epsilon plus R R star or epsilon plus R star R. Okay. So it can be written as R star. Okay. So it is epsilon plus R star R, it can be written R star. So it can be written as QP star. Okay. So if you see that this solution, if I put the solution in it, it will calculate to QP star. Okay. So that is also correct solution. Another proof is also given in the PPT. So that is also a valid solution. You can also go with. Okay. So the thing that you have to only remember, I will tell you that it is very easy to understand. There is nothing more to it. If you are able to draw a finite automata, then to derive a regular expression, it's very easy. Okay. So the first thing is the regular expression that comes out of Arden's theorems are very clean. Okay, so mostly they will be very clean. Okay, so the Arden's method, the regular expression that comes out from using the Arden's method, that will be very, very clean. Okay, so just I just want to show you that we have done the example. If I just remember the example of where we are saying even number of a's, yeah. So the automata for that was, if I just write it, that, okay. So the automata for that was even number of a's, it should be like this, q naught, a, and here it is b, here it is b, and any number of b's can come. So here it is, okay. So this is your automata for even number of b's. That we have written, I think we have directly write the regular expression as b star, any number of b's can come in the starting, after that it is followed by a star, in the middle any number of b's can come, after that a should come, after that any number of b's can come. I think we have written the regular expression, and also this single, any number of b's singly without seeing any a can also be get accepted, because b star means that it has even number of a's. Okay, so if you remember the previous lecture, we have done this expression. Okay, so just let me see if it is, I think it is correct. Just let me see, in the previous lecture we have done this. Okay, so this number of a's are even, yeah. So this is the same expression that we have done, and we have designed this regular expression without using any procedure. Okay, so you can do this, that also, but if there is some particular algorithm exists or particular method exists, so I suggest you will go with that. Okay, so you can directly derive out this, there is no problem in that, but you just have to see that all the strings that are generated by the language should be generated by this regular expression also. Okay, so the method is very, very simple. So just write it like this, q naught and q1. Okay, so I just do another example. So this is a bit difficult example, just because I remember there is something that we have to do. So we will do this example in second number. So the easiest example that I would follow, that to make you aware of the concept that what is Arden's lemma or Arden's theorem, I think we should go with that method. Take this will be very easy example. So keep that in mind, it can be a NFA or a DFA. If I am not defining any symbol, don't worry about that. Okay, so I think that is fairly easy. So to understand the concept of it, it is very simple. Now just listen to me carefully for the next 5 minutes, you will understand the concept of Arden's lemma. Okay, so I just write the equations, r equal to q plus rp, and the solution of this is a qp star. Okay, so this, I write it like this so that it is near. Okay, now start with the first state, that is your q1. So how can you reach q1? You can reach without seeing anything, because this is the starting state. So I can write epsilon that on q1, I can reach to this q1 without seeing anything. So I can write epsilon. Okay, in a similar way, how can you reach q2? So at q2, you can reach q2 from q1 by seeing a. Okay, so from q1 by seeing a, you can reach to q2. So you can write like this in the mathematical form. Okay, so now how other way? There is no other way you can reach q2. Okay, now on q3, if you see, now keep in mind that our final state is q3. So the regular expression that we are calculating will result here. Okay, so what is the result of, what will be the result of this q3 will be your regular expression. Okay, so keep that in mind. So when we are standing at the final state, the derivation of this state, but by applying Arden's theorem, what will be the result of it? It will be your regular expression. Okay. So now for q3, how can you reach q3? You can reach q3 from q1 by seeing a b, or you can reach q3 from q2 also by seeing a. Okay, so again you can reach Q3 by seeing a A of self loop of A. So it can be Q3 on A. Okay, so that there are three, there are three ways that you can reach Q3 from Q1, from Q2, and from Q3 also. Okay, so don't think that you can write it like this, that you can reach Q1 A, Q2 A. Okay, so don't, only it will only contain one state. Okay, so don't go back in the starting and you think that this Q1 A and Q2 is also being there. So only one state, keep that in mind, one state. Okay, so now what do I do? Now I know that this is my main and final equation, the result I will get from here. But here Q1 is written and Q2 is written and Q3 is already there. Okay, so I have to convert this equation to R equal to Q plus R. So the R is there, so RP I think I can see, but this I have to substitute the value of Q1 and Q2. So easily see, the value of Q1 here is epsilon, so epsilon multiplied with V is B, so it is again 1 multiplied with B, and see on Q2 here, Q2 it is Q1A. Okay, so Q1A, if you see the value of Q1A, it is again epsilon A, so it can be written as A dot A followed by a Q3A. Okay, so now if you see, you can write this expression as R equal to Q plus R. Okay, so this becomes your R. So this is Q3, where is Q3? This is Q3 and this is your RP. Okay, so now this whole expression will become your Q. Okay, so now your equation becomes R equal to Q plus RP. Now I have converted this equation to this. So the solution of this is R equal to QP star. So QP star is what? B plus AA star. No. QP star. So B plus AA, P star is what? A star. Okay. So now this is your resulting regular expression. Okay. So I hope you get it. There is nothing. When you reach at the final state, you just try to derive out the expression by substituting the values. Okay. So there is Q1, Q2. Now when I converted this, I just see that this is Q3 and this is Q3. So if you write the equation R, so this is R and this is R also, RP. RP can be written here. So the remaining expression, I just code it as Q. So it becomes that Arden's theorem, R equal to Q plus RP. So the solution is already exists, that it can be written as QP star. So what is Q here? B plus A followed by A. P star, what is P here? A. So I just write it, the solution of it. Okay. I hope you understand it. Now the second question. Okay, so just try to do this question yourself. I will tell you the solution in like 1 minute. So clearly see this. Whenever we are designing these kind of expression, try to see that suppose in this particular Q2, if I got an expression, I can also apply Arden's theorem to this Q2 also. Okay. So but here if you see that R, and here there is no R here. Okay, Q2 is not inside this expression, so that is why I cannot apply Arden's method here. In the same way, if Q1 exists in that, I can also apply Arden's theorem on that also. Okay, so don't think that we can only apply the Arden's method on the final state. It can also be applied on Q2 as well as Q1. If you are able to see the states that are written Q2, if I am seeing the Q2 here again, I can again apply the Arden's here also. Okay, so keep that thing in mind by solving this question. Now try to solve this question yourself. I will tell you the solution in like 4 minutes. So tell me the solution. What is your answer? Okay, try to solve it and tell me the solution. Okay, so one thing also, don't worry that this is a NFA. So don't worry about that. NFA, it can also be there. DFA can also be there. Okay, yes, yes. Siddharth, you have any problem? Okay, so I think Hemant, yeah. Hemant got the right answer. Think Priya, just let me see. B plus. Okay, so Priya, it can also be written like this. Hemant, all of your solution is correct. You just have to remember the expression, that is QP star. So you have to raise it to the power of star. Okay. I think Mrinal Bansal got the right answer. Yeah, absolutely correct. The answer by Mrinal. Okay. So now if you see, it is basically based on simplification. Okay. So if your simplification is good in mathematics, I don't think you will find it very, very difficult. Okay. So how, now we know that our answer will get on Q naught, because Q naught is our final state. Okay. So keep that thing in mind. Okay, so how can you reach Q naught? So by getting nothing, by seeing epsilon, you can reach Q naught, or by seeing a B, you can reach Q naught. Yeah, and other way. Oh, sorry for that. Yeah. Is there any problem here? Yeah. Okay, or seeing a B, you can reach Q naught, as well as on seeing Q1. From Q1, you can also reach Q0. So Q1 by seeing A can also reach Q1. I think these are the three remaining. So if you see, if I just try R exists here, so that is good. But there is Q1. So just see what is happening if I just replace that Q1. If I'm able to replace that Q1 with Q0, that will be very, very good for me. Okay. So now see for Q1. Again, I just write the equation here. R equal to Q plus RP. I think that is the equation. Yeah. And R equal to QP star is the solution. So Q1, from Q0, you can reach to Q1 by getting an A, or any other way, Q1 by getting input of B. Okay. So I don't think there is any other way. Yeah, absolutely. Okay. So now you see, if you can apply Arden's method here. So Arden's method can be applied here. If you clearly see, RP can be extracted from it. So I just assume it as Q. So if I just change the letter here, it can be written like this: Q1B followed by Q naught A. Okay. So Q1 can be now written like this: R equal to that is correct. I think previous placement was absolutely correct. So Q plus R, so it can be written like so this is Q plus RP. It can be written like QP star. So Q is what? Q naught A. P is what? B star. Okay, so that Q1 is reduced to this expression. So again, if you can apply Arden's method on any one of the following, any one equation, if you apply it, just see this. Okay, so now I got the value of Q1 here, so I just put it here. See, now by putting the value of Q1 here, so Q1 will be finished. Okay, so that is a good thing for me. So to arrange it, so it will become very, very, very easy for me for the arrangement of it. So epsilon plus Q naught B plus, if you replace this Q1 as Q naught A followed by A. Oh, sorry for that. Q naught A B star. So what is exactly Q1 is? Q1 is Q naught A B star followed by A. Okay, I think that there will be some silly mistake that A, some of the people forget to write that A. Okay, so don't forget to write that A. Okay, now just take Q naught common. There is nothing to it. So I just want to take a Q naught as common. Okay. Q naught, it will become B plus a b star a, yeah, okay. So if I take q not common here, it can be written like this, okay, b plus a star, okay. Now there is r and this is your q, and q plus r p. So keep that in mind. If you see, q can be lambda, q can belong to epsilon, though there is no condition, but the condition is p should not belong to a epsilon or a lambda, okay. Keep that in mind. So p here, p does not belong to epsilon, only q belongs to epsilon. So there is nothing wrong in it. We are again standing the conditions and assumptions of Arden's methods are already satisfied. So it can be written as q p star, okay. So what is q? Q is epsilon. P star is what? P plus a b star, a star, p star, okay. So this is p and write a star on it, okay. So no, if you are multiplying or concatenating epsilon with this, so it can be written like this: b plus a b star b and, okay. So if you clearly see the expression, this expression is totally different from this expression, okay. So this expression, if you clearly see, is also the right expression, but this is the expression that we have extracted from Arden's method is a very clean expression, okay. Okay, so I think your lecture is over. So again, so for homework, I will just want to tell that you can do one question like for Arden's another or also given in Dude. So this kind of a question where the length of the string are even, so this kind of a question. So we have already derived the regular expression for it. So you should derive the regular expression by using Arden's method and see if they are different from the one we have derived earlier. Okay, so again, thank you for listening, and you can move on to the next.
So
yes. I'm
sorry.